I'd like to speak to you on a simple subject of confused. Sometimes we're confused about what God is doing in our lives, where God is taking us, what His will is. We're not sure how to handle certain things that come. Should I go this way or should I go that way? And so it's really natural and normal to be confused at times. Have you ever waited for something to become better and it didn't? Have you ever hoped that a relationship would improve and it didn't improve? Samuel was waiting for King Saul to apologize, an apology that never came. King Saul stepped out of the will of God and he began doing his own thing and became a rebel, and Samuel prayed for him, and in praying for him, he was hoping that King Saul would come around, but he didn't. So what do you do? What do you do when your expectations of yourself, expectations of people are frustrated? The healthy thing to do is to learn how to let it go and move on. Kenny Rogers said that you got to know when to hold them and you got to know when to fold them. You got to know when to walk and you got to know when to run. And sometimes, and that's just another way of saying what the Bible has said. Now, in the Italian version, it's forget about it. Close the door and move ahead. Take on your next assignment. Now, that is exactly what Isaiah is telling us in the 43rd chapter. He says, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Sometimes it's the things in our past that grip us, that keep us from enjoying the present and stepping into the future. Even Paul said, forgetting those things which are behind, I press towards the mark. The only way you can press towards the mark, which is step into the future, is to do something about the past. Don't remember the former things. There are things in our lives that we need to forget. Now, there are some things we should never forget, but there are some things that chip away at our self-esteem and our attitude that we need to put aside and forget. And so what God did, God is went to Samuel and said, Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul? See, and I've rejected him from reigning over Israel. Stop praying. Can you imagine God saying, stop praying? And God told him to stop praying because I have found myself a king among his sons. So God is telling Samuel, it's time to move ahead. It's time to let go of the past. And it's time to move ahead in the future. I've picked one of the sons of Jesse to be the next king. Now, the obvious thing would be, which one? And let me tell you something about God. That's the reason why we get confused by the Lord. God doesn't always fill in all of the blanks you want to fill in. He didn't tell Samuel which son. In fact, if you read through that chapter, he says, I'll show you. Samuel probably was wondering, well, which? Sometimes God gives you just enough information for you to take the next step. Because the scripture says the steps of a good man, they're ordered by the Lord. And God gives us enough light to take the next step, but you're still left in the dark because you don't know where the following step is going to take you. And so we've got to learn how to live with the blanks in our lives. And we all have blanks somewhere. We just don't know what God's next move is going to be in our lives. That's why we sing that song, One Day at a Time, Sweet Jesus. That's all I'm asking of you. Give me the strength that I need to be able to make it through. That's what the Lord does. He just gives us one day. Let me explain what I mean. God is saying to Abraham, Abraham, follow me, but I'm not going to tell you where. That takes a step of faith. And God tells Moses, follow me, but I'm not going to tell you how we're going to deliver the children of Israel. And God says to Abraham, you are going to have the promised son, but But God doesn't tell him when. Have you ever asked God, Lord, I know you're doing something in my life, but when? I would just like to know when. Sometimes God cannot tell us when, because if he told us when, we wouldn't really understand it. Like, for instance, God is telling Abraham, Abraham, you're going to have a promised son, but you won't get him until you're 99 years old. Now, that would be a problem. I remember years ago when the kids were little, we used to go to Mojave Lake on houseboating. And so this one year, we're planning to go on a houseboating, and Nancy Ann announced it to the kids. And Joey says, how long before we go? And Nancy had said, 1 month. And Joey said, how long is a month? He's just little. He didn't know about time. And Nancy Ann said, 30 days. He said, how long is that? Nancy went to the store, bought a fishing rod, brought it home, and told Joey, I'm putting this fishing rod by the bed. Every morning when you wake up, you're going to look at the fishing rod, and you're going to remember the promise. The promise is that we are going to go to the houseboat. Sometimes the only thing that you can hold on to is the promise that God has given you, because God is not answering where or when or how. God is just giving you the promise. And if the only thing that we've got is the promise, that's enough. Sometimes we're kept in the dark. And it'd be nice if God gave us a little bit more of an explanation, but he doesn't. So the scripture tells us that Samuel did what the Lord said, and he went to Bethlehem. And he introduced himself to Jesse, and he told Jesse, one of your sons is going to be anointed the next king. And so Jesse brought out his oldest son first, which was Eliab. And Samuel looked at Eliab, the oldest son, and said, surely this is the Lord's anointed as before him. He looked like a king. He had the attitude of a king, whatever that attitude of a king is. And God told him, said, no, don't look on his appearance or at his physical stature, because I've refused him. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Now, the problem with that is you can't see the heart. All you can see is the outward appearance. So the only things that we can go on is the things that we can see. But God actually looks past what you could see and sees the heart. And that's what God told Samuel. Don't look on his outward appearance. And then seven of Jesse's sons pass by Samuel, and each one is rejected. Now I want you to see this. Samuel is standing there. Jesse has seven of his sons pass by, and they're all rejected, and Samuel is still standing around, and Jesse's standing around, and Samuel doesn't know what to do, so he says, Jesse, do you have any more children? Jesse didn't even think to include David. And then Samuel said to Jesse, are all your sons here? Jesse said, there's yet the youngest, and he's tending the sheep. The father actually didn't even consider David as possibly being chosen as the next king. And so Jesse sent and brought David. Now he was ruddy, with bright eyes, and good looking. Notice that. He was ruddy, with bright eyes, and good looking. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is the one. But wait a minute. All of those features are outward appearances. Ruddy, bright eyes, and good looking. God had just told Samuel, don't look at the outward appearances, because I look at the heart. When David is introduced to Samuel, he's introduced as ruddy, bright eyed, and good looking. And when I'm reading this, has God ever confused you? Because he says, on one hand, I don't want you to look at the outward appearance. On the other hand, he points to the outward appearances. That's a little bit on the confusing end. And I started thinking about that. I said, you know that God does things like that. God will say one thing, and then something else happens, and it seems Jesse saw a shepherd boy. God saw a king. Jesse saw a boy tending his sheep, and God saw a man after his own heart. Because God does not see the way we see. God saw what he was becoming. The world sees the fishermen and the tax collectors, but Jesus saw a church triumphant, which the gates of hell would not be able to prevail against. And so God does things. He does things that are strange. Did you ever expect God to call the foolish to confound the wise? I mean, how do you do that? How do you call the foolish to confound the wise? And how do you call the weak to confound those that are strong and mighty? God sometimes does things that are really strange and confusing. God called a shy boy to be a preacher. Now, if there ever was anything that was stranger, that was strange to me. I remember when I went to Bible school, I was intimidated by the kids that were in Bible school because they could, at the drop of a pen, preach a message with 3 points and an altar call, and I was tongue-tied, and I'm saying, Lord, I know you called me into the ministry, but I can't do this. It's amazing the things that God does. Sometimes he'll call a fish and tell the fish to fly. And that's how I felt. I'll call a bird and tell it to swim. Because God can do things that will confuse. Let me prove it. Let me prove you. God can do things that confuse you. Peter's up on a roof, and God shows him a vision. A sheet comes down from heaven with all these wild animals. All these wild animals. And a voice comes and says, kill and eat. Peter says, no way. And God says, don't call unclean what I call clean. Peter could have said, you called it unclean in the Old Testament. And now God is calling it clean. Well, we know the reason that God did this is to wake up in Peter the fact that God was going to be speaking to the Gentiles. But when it first came to Peter, it was confusing. Has God ever confused you with something that he's done? God tells Abraham, Abraham, I want you to sacrifice your son, Isaac. So Abraham climbs up the Mount of Moriah with Isaac, places him on an altar with the wood and is ready to plunge the knife into him when a voice from heaven says, don't do it. I can imagine Abraham saying, you told me to do it. God says, no, don't do it because this is just a test. How do you know? How do you know whether or not whatever God is telling you is just simply a test? He's testing you. And the way he goes about doing it is a very confusing way. Now, let me prove it to you even further so we can get down to where we live. Jesus said this. He said, come unto me, all you who are laboring and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. We accept that verse. It's very comforting. But Jesus turns to the same people, his disciples, and he says, behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves. The same Jesus that said, come unto me and I'll give you rest, is saying, I'm going to send you among, you know, if you're a lamb and you're going among wolves, you're not feeling any kind of rest. You got nothing but stress. And yet there's that contradiction. There's that contrast. Jesus is saying one thing here, and he says another thing here. And at the time when we're going through it, when we first go through it, we are confused. I don't understand. The scripture teaches us that he will give us a peace that passes all understanding. Jesus says, my peace I give you, not as this world gives you. And then Jesus says, I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. How do you handle that? Now, we know that when the sword comes, God's cutting away things so that we can enjoy the peace that he wants us to have. But I just want you to see it. The fact that Jesus said, I'm coming to give you a peace that passes all understanding. And I haven't come to bring peace, but I've come to bring a sword. It's a little confusing. Has God ever confused you? That two ways are presented to you, and you don't know which one God is choosing for you? And it's just like God says, I want you to come to the promised land. Follow me to the promised land. And when you start following him, you realize you're in a wilderness. and that the only way to the promised land is through the wilderness. But your mind was on the promised land, and God's mind was on the wilderness because he was preparing you for the promised land. And so, but it comes across as confusing. Has God ever confused you? Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed David in the midst of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. What God does is he prepares us. He gives us the help that we need for the confusion that's going to be coming. David's about ready to be confused. David does not know what's coming in the future, but he's about ready to be confused. And the Spirit of God, here's the reason why we need God's Spirit in our lives, because only God's Spirit can help us navigate through the problems that we're going through. We can't even understand the things that we're going through unless the Spirit of God comes and helps us. When the children of Israel were in the wilderness, God sent a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. That symbolizes the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will take them through the bad times in the wilderness so they could get through the promised land. That's why the Bible says we need to be filled with God's Spirit. Jesus said this, the Holy Spirit comes, he's going to lead you and guide you into all truth. Why does he need to lead us and guide us into all truth? Because we're going to be confused. That's why. And we need the Holy Spirit to guide us. And so God sends his Holy Spirit. Now you would think that when David is anointed and the Holy Spirit comes upon him, and remember he's anointed to become the next king, well, the next thing is going to be the palace. And the answer to that would be, well, yes and no. Now, if somebody answered one of your questions with yes and no, is that a little confusing? Yes, you're going to go to the palace, but it's not really what you think. But wait a minute, I was anointed to be the next king, and I'm going to the palace, right? Yes, you're going to the palace, but no, you're not going to the palace to be the king. Here's what happened. Saul, at this time, had an evil spirit come upon him and became greatly depressed. Somehow, the king was told that David could play the harp, and he would be able to chase away the evil spirit. And so Saul sends for David. Saul sent messages to Jesse and said, send me your son David, who is with the sheep. I want you to notice something. When David was found, he was found with the sheep. But just before he was found with the sheep, he was anointed to become the next king. What is he doing with the sheep? You would think he's out there getting new robes to prepare for being the king. But he's out there with the sheep. And I want you to know the reason why David is still out there with the sheep, even when Saul calls him to the palace. It's because David, who's watching his sheep, is also flinging stones, practicing his slingshot. He's also out there looking at caves. And why? Because in the very next chapter, he's going to need the slingshot to face Goliath. And in the chapters after that, King Saul's going to be after him to kill him. And he needs to know where the caves are. You want to know something? What you're doing today is important because of what's coming tomorrow. So sometimes we think the little mundane things that we're doing today is just meaningless and purposeless, and we don't realize that in God's plan, what you're doing today is important. So we ought to stop getting discouraged about what we're doing today and remember that God's got a bigger plan than we can think of, and he can't explain the whole thing to us, but whatever it is that we're doing is important because tomorrow is coming, and tomorrow he's going to need a slingshot, and the day after that he's going to need to know where the caves are. And so David is with the sheep because he is being trained for the kingdom. David would take a harp and play it with his hand. Then Saul would become refreshed and well, and the distressing spirit would depart from him. David went to the palace, but he didn't go to the palace to sit on the throne. He went to the palace to play the harp to chase the evil spirit away from King Saul. Listen, God has got a plan. He does not sit down and explain the whole plan to us. I think if he did, we wouldn't know what to do with it. So God gives it to us one step at a time. Today a little bit, and tomorrow a little bit. Because David is in the palace, but he's playing for the king because he got to start at the bottom. When God's calling you to great things, you start at the bottom. I graduated from Bible school with straight A's. I've mentioned this many times. I was the valedictorian, and here I am ready to take on my world. And I became a church custodian. Because you have to start at the bottom. And it's easy to become discouraged when you're at the bottom, because what you're doing is you're in a delayed pattern. And it's always difficult to be delayed when you're rushing on the inside to get somewhere and something happens and now you're delayed. God uses delays in our lives. And this is how he uses it. He uses the delay to develop character. He makes us stronger. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. That's why God uses delay. We don't like that. But if you want to know what to do, you came to church, you get the truth. Here's the truth. The truth is God uses delays to develop our character. What we don't always realize sometimes is that the devil also uses delays. The devil uses delays to discourage us. Let me give you an example. When Carolyn was born on August the 29th, I was the custodian of the church. That week, it had rained all week long, and the church, where I was the custodian, the basement was flooded. On top, now Nancy's at the hospital giving birth to Carolyn. I was there for the birth, and I had to run back to the church because the church basement was flooded. And on top of that, the sewer backed up. So here I am, I'm the only one at the church. G.I. Joe, here I am, and I got to take care of a backed up sewer and also a flooded basement, and I got this wet back, and I'm going crazy, and I feel smelly. Nancy's in the hospital, Caroline is born, and this is what I'm thinking as I'm down in the basement. How am I going to explain this to my daughter someday, that your dad, who graduated with honors, is a church custodian? Just what I did. I did this. I couldn't even say the words because I didn't even believe what it was I was humming. But what I was humming was, you'll understand it better by and by. But I didn't believe it. You know, sometimes people say, if you're a pastor, you're a man of faith. You're a great man of faith. If God had to deal with faith, it'd never pick me. I was frustrated. How am I going to explain it? Not only am I going to explain this to Carol Ann when she gets older, how am I going to explain this to my mother-in-law and my father-in-law? I'm a custodian in a church. I don't get that. But the day came when I was able to say the words, and we'll understand it better by and by. Sometimes God uses delays to help us. The devil uses it to whisper into our ear, yea, hath God said? Did God say that you were reserved for ministry? Look at you, with a mop in your hand. A basement is flooded, and the stewards, yay. You see how the devil works? The devil will take the experiences and the circumstances you're in, and he'll whisper in you, yay, hath God said? And then you can sing back to them, and we'll understand it better by and by. But you have to have a little experience to be able to sing that with any kind of conviction. But the truth is, God uses delay to develop our character. The devil will use it to discourage us, but we can still sing, we'll understand it better by and by. So bye-bye, devil. I just want you to know you're not going to do what it is you want to do in my life. David is with the sheep because God's got plans for him, and he goes there and plays for King Saul because you start at the bottom. And we sometimes ask this question, say, Lord, how long do I have to wait? I know you've done this because I've done this. How long do I have to wait for the promise? You made a promise and you said some things, and I'm waiting and waiting. And you know, while you're waiting on God, God's waiting on you. We wait for him, and he waits for us. He's a father. And the father is pacing back and forth, waiting for his son. My son left with a pocket full of money. He went to paint the town red. I wonder when he's coming back. And he paces. And his son runs into a famine and loses his shirt. And his robes are in tatters. And his father waits. I wonder when my son is coming back. His son loses all of his friends. He loses his job. He loses his credit. And the father wonders, when will my son come back? Will my son come to his senses and come back home? Will my son let go of his pride and leave the pigs and be willing to humbly come back to Dad? Dad's waiting for his son, and let you know how much the father believes in a son who's wayward. He's got his robe ironed and his shoes ashine, and his ring is polished, and his chair is reserved, and the servants are prepared. Waiting for a wayward son to come back home. Do you know why God waits? You know why God is delayed? The scripture says this: the Lord, who is not slack concerning his promises, but is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. What if it is God is waiting for you, waiting to give you mercy, waiting to forgive you, waiting to let you know that you're accepted, waiting for you to come, to get up from wherever it is you are and shake off whatever it is you've been in and head back home? Why? Because your dad is waiting, not to give you a tongue lashing. He's waiting to tell you, welcome home, son. I've been waiting a long time for this. That's the kind of a God we serve. So it's true that we are going to be confused by the things that God does or doesn't do in our lives, but we got to remember that God is also waiting for us. He's waiting for us to humbly come back into his presence. Lord, I'm coming home. I'd like to open up the altar. I'd like you to think about these words. As you come, and I'll be glad to pray with you.